Hello and welcome! This video is supposed to show you how to install and use the Blender add-on Advanced Ocean Modifier. So let's open a new blend file and get the add-on installed. To install the add-on, you go to Edit, Preferences, you go to Install, and then you look through your folder where you can find the downloaded zip file. This is the version I will install now. I search for Advanced Ocean Modifier, and then if it's not enabled, I enable it. The add-on menu can be found now in the 3D viewport in the end panel, in the right-hand panel here of the 3D viewport. Here in the tab Advanced Ocean. In the beginning, you will see you have only the two buttons. The second button allows you to apply the ocean material to any object, but typically you only press a generate ocean to get everything started. Yeah, and here we are. We have our ocean, and the add-on already did a few things in the background. For example, it added some collections here you can ignore and should not mess with. It installed a material. Let's get Eevee to load that. Which now looks a bit greenish and weird. This because it only reflects the HDRI in the viewport. So we can change that, for example, with something with a blue sky. And already it looks more like a nice water ocean scene. The first panel is about setting up the ocean. Starts with three presets with a lovely, lively, and a stormy ocean to get you started. The two most important values in working fast and efficient with the ocean modifier is the render resolution, and starting from Blender 2.91 you also have a viewport resolution. The resolution defines how many vertices you have that gets displaced. With very low values, you get a nice performance, but it looks very rough. Increasing the value will give you a more detailed ocean, but on the cost of performance. This is also important if you consider things we do a little bit later in this video for floating objects. If you have a floating object but the resolution is too low, you will see you get a very jagged movement. And keep in mind, the viewport resolution only sets up the resolution while you're working in the viewport. And the render resolution is the one that gets applied when you actually render it. The next option is also new in Blender 2.91, and it's called Spectrum. This includes four types of models used to simulate the ocean. The turbulent ocean should be used for turbulent seas with foam. The second option is the established ocean. This should be used for large area oceans where the wind blows for miles over the sea and waves and wind already reached an equilibrium. The established ocean with sharp peaks is a related model to this. The last option is a shallow water option. It should be used for water with a depth of less than 10 meters. The next three values are about changing the size of the ocean. The first two are the repeat X and repeat Y, where you get more tiles of the ocean. This can lead to some repetitions if you use high values. And of course, also here, if the vertice count goes up, the performance goes down. The next value is the spatial size. It defines how long one of those edges is. If I increase this value, you see the size of the ocean increases. However, you also see that the wave height is not increasing. So, when I have problems fitting the size of the waves to an object, this is typically the value I start with to adjust the relationship between waves and an object. The next value is the wave alignment. The higher the value is, the more waves move in the same direction. So if it's 1, all the waves move from the right to the left. And if you put it down, all the waves bouncing around, happy in all directions. With a wave scale, you can change the height of the waves, but you often get some ugly artifacts on the edges, which you can compensate with the pointiness factors. The pointiness 2, for example, makes everything round if you put it down, or you can make stuff a lot more edgy. I typically turn that down to get rid of all the problems on top of the waves and fine-tune it with the pointiness 1 value to get like the shape on top of the waves I really want. Another interesting value is the smallest wave value. In higher resolutions, you can adjust with this how many of the small waves will actually appear. So if you put it to 0, you have a lot of small waves in here. And the higher you put the value, the more those disappear and it gets smoother and you only get the big waves on top. The next panel allows you to control the interaction of objects with the ocean. You basically have two main options: float objects and static objects. Pressing float objects, having the cube selected, generates a float animation cage. And you see the object is moving with the waves. The float animation cage has several tasks. In general, it defines where the cube or the object will float. So you can use it to animate the object over path or just play around like I do. To animate an object, you go to the first frame in the timeline, add a location keyframe, go to another frame, move the animation cage, and add a new location keyframe. As you see, the cube boss is not moving directly with it, but in the moment I press play, the cube is jumping to the animation cage. You always have to press play to update the animation. So if you go back, you will see the animation cage is moving and the cube is moving happily on his journey through the ocean. The orientation of the cube can be defined by rotating the animation cage in Z direction. Now we have something that could be the front, and if we play it, you see it's moving in the wrong direction. So we rotate the float animation cage to move the cube in the right direction. And if you want to make a turn, so we make another movement. So now he turns a corner, so we begin here where he probably starts to turn, something like that. Over here, put a rotation keyframe, go a bit behind, we should have the direction, rotate on Z, put the rough direction, press E, we set a rotation keyframe. And now we have our little animation of the boat turning. The float animation cage also solves the task to define how much the object is affected by the waves. This is done by changing the size of the float animation cage. So if it's bigger, the object moves a lot less, and it's a lot less affected by the waves than if you have a very small float animation cage. You see, it moves very quickly. this is very important to change the behavior, for example, for a container ship in comparison to a little paper boat. The paper boat will move a lot faster in the waves and will be a lot more affected by it, where a container ship will hardly be moved by these kinds of small waves. The other main option is the static object option. If you press this, the object will move back to its original place. No float animation cage. In this state, an object is not affected by the waves, but the object will influence the ocean. So you can move around freely and animate your object as you usually would in Blender. The next option is the remove interaction. If you press this, you have removed all interaction with the ocean and you have your old object back. Never try to just delete the float animation cage and then change around, because there's so much stuff in the background that needs to be changed. Let the add-on do all the work. The next option is a cage visibility. You can toggle the cage visibility with this button. This is very helpful if you have like 20 objects, all those little cages, and it's very good to keep an overview of the scene. The last part of this panel allows you, for one, to control the duration of the simulation. When you change the value, all the dynamic paint canvases and of course the ocean will be updated to simulate over this period of time. And the second part is the general control of ocean foam or object foam. If you disable it, press update, you will see that the ocean foam is disappearing and the object foam is disappearing. And if I enable the object foam, you see it's back now. Next panel is about the ocean foam settings. The first one is the fade. The fade is the time the object foam needs to disappear. Let me show you. For example, this little trail of foam the objects have behind them. And if you increase this value be to a very high number, then it takes very long that the foam disappears behind the object. The next option is the ocean foam coverage. This means like how much foam you want to have in general on your ocean. Dial it in as you like. But keep in mind that the material settings will also have an effect on how this will look. The next panel is about the waves the object produces in the ocean. So let me show you. If you move an object, you see it pushes away water, which flow together again behind the object, producing this wave. The damping controls how much the ocean resists this deformation. With very high values, you can even make holes in the water. The next value is spring. It defines the elasticity of the ocean. When I move my object, you see how the frequency of the outgoing waves increases. The last value is the smoothness. The smoothness defines how lively your ocean reacts. The more you reduce the value, the more little waves your object will produce. The last panel is about the ocean material settings. The first value is the color of the ocean. Well, it looks blue now, but we saw before that this is only the reflection of an HDR eye. So with this value, you can tint the color of the ocean. The second value is the roughness. Then you can also control the transparency of the ocean, which is very helpful for pool scenes, for example. And of course, the index of refraction. The second part of the panel is the foam material. The first one, of course, also you can tint the color of the foam. The second one is the roughness. You see, you put it down and you see more of the sunset reflections. The transmission is a translucency parameter. With higher numbers, you can see more through the foam. The patchiness allows you to adjust the size of the individual patches. The bubble size controls the size of the bubbles in the middle. So higher values will give you smaller bubbles. Smaller values give you bigger bubbles. The bubble noise threshold defines the gradient between the different sized bubbles and the noise pattern at the edges of each patch. The more you reduce a value, the more the noisy edge disappears and you get a foam that appears more light. And last but not least, the bump and displacement values. For EV, I recommend only using the bump option. And in cycles, I recommend using the displacement option and putting the bump option down to 0.